Yeah, guys, so today we will be starting with the business analytics. So some of the terms that are being displayed on the screen are with you. So is there any other term which you think about apart from the terms that have been mentioned over the screen?
Statistics.
So big
Yes,
data.
statistical analysis. Okay. Big data. Yeah, any other term? Any other term which anybody can think of?
Languages like Python,
डी जांगो में भी समथिंग
ओके
लाइक
okay.
एंड सर केरास आल्सो समथिंग लाइक केरास
टेंसर फ्लो
Keras,
यस
TensorFlow, SKLearn, NumPy,
MySQLearn,
नंपाय पांडास
Pandas, NLTK, Natural Language Processing.
This is NLP, ओके
है टेक्स्ट ट्रेनिंग
टेक्स्ट माइनिंग
फ्रंट एंड इंजीनियर बैक एंड इंजीनियर
सीक्वेंस लर्निंग
सीक्वल सीक्वेंस लर्निंग ओके
एस सीक्वेंस लर्निंग रीइंफोर्समेंट
रीइंफोर्समेंट लर्निंग सुपरवाइज लर्निंग अनसुपरवाइज लर्निंग ओके सो लेट मी टेल यू सो गाइस I will color this down. So the ones with the similar meaning, or the ones that fall in the same category, I will color it down. One is, so they're different heads. One is data and present insights. To business. Okay. Second term is now I'll write down only five, six things and I'll color all these things down to the same bucket, same color of any of the thing, and they will fall in the same category. Then I will explain you what is it and how it is difference. They're different from each other. Okay. So first head is analyzing. So these are the five buckets. I have been placing the similar kind of items into these five buckets and I'll be coloring it out, analyzing the data and present insights to the business. Second is future. Third is report generation. When I say report generation, this is similar to say 1, 2, 3. This is similar to one. Analyzing data and present is insight to business. But the reports that are being generated are through some of the advanced softwares like Tableau, Power BI, ClickView, and many more. Okay, so this is report generation. So this also cover analysis and insights, but through advanced visualization. Okay, like Tableau, Power BI, ClickView, which I mentioned. Fourth part is analysis. Fifth part is data engineering. Okay. Sixth is languages. So I can see all these things into six heads. And even if you'll say me to further reduce it to five or four heads, I can do that. But I will not do that just to avoid confusion amongst you. So when I say business, so the color is, I'll keep this and this as light green and dark green. Because they are similar. And this statistical analysis as a portion of green, but a very light green. These three are similar and always talk to each other. Predicting the future, I will color it as light orange. Languages, I will cover it as blue. Data engineering, I'll color it as gray. This is green only, but the shade of green is not coming. I'll say this green. Is it clear, guys? Anybody any doubt till now?
Sir, can we add forecasting engineer?
So this is forecasting. When we say predicting, it is it is forecasting as well. Forecasting is when we have a time series data. Predicting is if we have the share when we do prediction is share in share market, it is forecasting. But when we do prediction in whether a person has a cancer or not, it is known as prediction. When it comes to predicting with respect to time, it is forecasting. When it comes to predicting with respect to other variables, it is prediction. Got it?
Okay.
But both falls in the same category. Okay. So I'll also add a term here. Time series. Okay. So when I say analyzing data presenting to the business, this is one. That is a green color. Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah.
So can you explain again about this color representation of five things?
This?
Yes.
So the first one, the number one, means we have the data in a simple Excel sheet. You have a simple data in a form of Excel sheet, for example. And what you are doing is, you are analyzing that data and presenting it in form of say, Excel graphs. Even not in Excel graphs, then you're presenting it in a form of simple analysis. Say sales, how sales is increasing, sales is decreasing, and all the things you are doing. This is the first head. That is analyzing the data and presenting insights to the business. And you are saying the sales is increasing, sales is decreasing because the sale of item A has increased, B has reduced, and all this analysis that you have been preparing with that. A simple, very simple example of that is sir, analyzing it. Yeah.
That is nothing but visualization of data, as you said earlier.
So I will tell you about, so this is also a visualization which I just told you. This also includes making graphs, and in case you're even not making graphs, then also it will come into this category.
Okay, sir.
Second is predicting the future. When I say predicting the future means tomorrow you will be able to attend the class or not is the thing which I can predict. In case I have the historical data of the similar students who have been studied in the class, so this is known as predicting the future. I can predict the future wherever I have the historical data. This is known as predicting the future. Got it? Second color. The number three is report generation. So whenever you have analyzed the data in point number one, in case you are presenting it in a beautiful format, you are giving an option for the user to play around. You're saying, drop the sales into a cell and you will get a sale for 2021 as well. Drop the cell, say name of people and you will get
the name of people automatically added to the graph. So this is the extension of whatever I mentioned in point number one. Is through report generation, developing dashboards through advanced visualization applications like Power BI, Tableau, ClickView, ClickSense, and many more. With me?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
The fourth one is
yes,
statistics. Yeah, the fourth one is anybody any question?
Sir, can you explain the third one once again?
So when we have analyzed the data in point number one, when the data is available in simple Excel format, so in case you have the data that is present in a very in a different format, and you are giving, so let's example, you log in into any of the website. Okay. You have been given an option that you drag certain things into a certain region. Let's example, you have been asked that you drag some of the products into any of the bucket in on the website, and it will automatically calculate the price for you. And so whenever you're presenting any analysis, anything in a very beautiful format where you're giving the option to, like, whether you are or you are not giving the option to the user to play around with the deck, to play around with whatever you have presented. So let's say, example, you have to present the sales of 2020, 21, 22 to 25. So you are giving the user an advanced visualization kind of a thing. The user can drag 2020 and the sales of 2020 will automatically populate. It will be automatically made on the graph and all the things you have been doing. So this is, you're simply analyzing the data through beautiful reports and visualization. So this comes under the category of report generation. So first and third are similar. That's why I have put them into a range of a green color only. The only difference being report generation only adds a beautiful visualization to whatever analysis you have presented in point number.
Yes.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
So the fourth one is statistical analysis. So statistical analysis is a very important and very beautiful concept. This basically says that apart from the normal analysis that you have been doing, what you are actually doing is you are bringing a statistical angle to it. So you have a sample. You have a sample of five candies, five toffees, and you need to estimate whether 1,000 toffees that are coming, 1,000 toffees that are in the bag or 1,000 toffees that are somewhere else, are the weight of these 1,000 toffees will be similar to the five toffees you're carrying. You are going to purchase some chairs for your office, let's example, and you have seen that there are 10,000 chairs you need to purchase. But the vendor has shown you a sample of one chair. How to make statistical decision with the help of that chair, whether to buy or not to buy those 1,000 chairs. So this comes under the category of statistical analysis. When you need to make some decision, this is the limited resources available on the thing that can go in a very high in range or very high in. So all this comes under the category of statistical analysis. With me?
Sir, means in statistical analysis, there is a calculation of mean, mode, median, etc.
Yeah, mean, median, mode, probability distributions, hypothesis testing, inferential statistics, ANOVA, MANOVA, ANCOVA, all these things will come under this.
Okay.
With me?
Yes, sir.
The fifth part comes under data engineering. When we say data engineering, it means you have, so this means everything you are doing is with respect to data storage, data pipelining, data warehouse, data lake, big data. So whenever it comes to data, how the data is being stored, how the data is being accessed, how the data is being populated, that comes under the category of data engineering. Here you are not doing any analysis. Here you are just making the ways that your, how your data can be stored, how your data can be accessed, how your data can be pre-processed, and all these things with a less amount of time. It comes under the category of data engineering. With me?
Yes, sir.
The last is languages. When we say languages normally mean that whenever we have, so nowadays data is available into different variety. So earlier data is meant to be the data that is available in the form of numbers, say sales, whatever can be stored in Excel kind of a form. But right now the field of this data or the meaning of this data has been extended to data that can come from a text, the data that can come from images, the data that can come from videos, the data that can come from say a number of other things as well, a number of other sources as well, is also being considered into a category called unstructured data. So the data that is not in a form of a simple data is known as unstructured data. For example, data in images, the data in text, the data in videos, the data in n number of other things as well is called unstructured data. The data is not structured as it can be in the form of rows and columns. So one part of it is the data that is available in text is known as working on the data with languages. So whenever you have data in English language, in Spanish language, for example, you are seeing a person is chatting with other person, okay, through any of the chat video, and you want to analyze how the health of the chat is going, whether the person is happy, not happy, okay, not okay, what are the sentiments that are going, all these things if you need to analyze it, even more than that, then it comes into the category of languages. With me?
Yes, sir.
So now let me tell you in which category each of this will go to. Business analytics will go to category number 1 or category number
3.
Yeah. Sorry. 1 or 3. Data analytics
data analytics goes in number 1.
Number 1.
Yes.
And
3. No, 5.
3 data, and data 4. No. Data engineering is different. 1, 3, 4. Even business.
1, 3, 4.
Even business analytics go to 1, 3, 4. So this is the thing which I've been telling from my understanding. The thing which I have observed, and even for the industry, 90% time it is same only. But some of the time nowadays, the new terms that are being coming, so they have been categorizing it further down. But these are the things which are as per my understanding, which I will tell.
So it can be in category 2 also?
No. So this category 2 is a thing that comes under this machine learning, AI. Business intelligence is only category number 3. Business visualization is again category number 3. Predictive modeling is a thing that comes
four.
Sorry.
Probability comes under the statistical.
Yeah.
So how come machine learning comes under predicting the future?
Machine learning is all the thing taking the inferences from the historical data and predicting on the future data is the machine learning. Deep learning and AI both.
So I think machine learning is one also.
No, machine learning is not one. When we do machine learning, we also do a bit of exploratory data analysis. That is one.
But sir, we can only predict the future after we have analyzed the data.
So that's why we have been
using these two things together, what is exploratory data analysis and machine learning together.
Actually, machine learning comes for the using the algorithms to build up the model.
Yeah.
And those models are used for predicting the future.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So machine learning is a concept that has certain algorithms that will help you for predicting the future. And before that, whatever you do, it comes under exploratory data analysis, business analytics, data analytics, whatever you want to see. Okay. When we say statistical modeling, it is four only statistical modeling. Okay, this comes into the hypothesis testing and all the things that we will be covering. When we say data modeling against, when we say modeling the data, which means we have been preparing the machine learning models here. So the term is used interchangeably. It is two only. Data mining. Data understanding, it comes under the category of one or three only. Sorry.
One, three, four.
Yeah. Data mangling, again, it is same. Data wrangling, again, same. Statistical analysis comes under four. Big data comes under five. Data engineering is five only. Language is R, Python.
Six.
So these are the languages which helps. No. This is different. This is not a language I have been talking about. This I will say language processing.
NLP.
So these are the tools. These are the tools which are used to do line item number one, two, not three. A bit of three as well. Nowadays they have functionality to present visualization, but that's not the basic motive. I'll say four.
Five.
And six. Not five. For data engineering, we have different tools. We have big data. We have Hadoop. We have Elastic MapReduce. We have Pig. We have Hive. We have n number of other things we have for data engineering. We have Cosmos DB, we have S3, we have Data Lake, we have Data Warehouse, and number of other things, but it's not like that. Okay.
So the names you are taking, are these the softwares or the language or what?
These are softwares and languages both. When I say Pig, Hive, these are the languages. SQL, this is the language. When I say big data using Hadoop, this is the application software, Hadoop. When I say Cosmos DB, Cosmos DB is a database in Azure Cloud. S3 is a database in Amazon Cloud. Redshift is again a database in cloud. When we say RDS is again a database in AWS Cloud. So these are the type of databases that we have in different types. So that comes under the category of data engineering.
Sir, one question, may I?
Yeah.
What is a database actually? Like storage of data?
So let's say example, you have, let's say that your age is say 25. Okay. So whatever you have done till now, starting from, say you have been, when you turned 18 or 17 or 16, you started writing a diary. So in this diary, what you have been doing, you have been writing your notes and storing it in a notepad, in a notepad, a hard copy kind of thing. So this is what? This is a database that you have made of your historical movements, of your historical learnings, experience. It is a data. So similar is the thing. When I put anything in an Excel kind of a format, any data which I've been putting on Excel, on SQL, or if you have even more bigger data, I've been using more bigger databases, Oracle or many more things, then it is a database.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Then what is the difference between warehouse and database?
No, data warehouse and database, when we say data warehouse is a thing that is used within database.
Two, it helps you to structure the data in a way that it is easily available to you, readily available to you in the database through a technique called data warehouse. So let's say example, you have house, you have your house. In this house, you have been placing different things all together. You have been placing sofa, you have been placing dining, you have been placing TV and number of things. So whatever you place in it, whatever you place in the database, whatever you arrange in a database is in the form of a data warehouse.
Okay.
So basically, in data warehouse, we categorize all the data and information that comes under one particular category.
So we categorize the different types of data. So data is meant to be stored in a database. But when you say data warehouse, so data warehouse means you are placing a data in a such a format that it is readily available to you whenever it is required in most efficient way, is a technique that is used to store data in database. With me?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
When I say Django, when I say Flask, these are the libraries or these are the applications in Python. Used for front end application development. Okay. When we say front end is, whenever you develop a page, web page, any other page, any application, that is a front end. So Django and Flask are the Python environments which helps you to develop the front end applications. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
What is back end?
Back end is when you work on. So there are basically three kind of layers in any of the application that we make. First is database layer. Second is application layer. That is basically the logical layer. And third is the front end layer. Okay, application layer is when you develop a logic. Let's example, you go to any of the website. On a website, you select any of the product. So let's example, you are going to Amazon.com website. You select a pair of socks. Okay, you say add to cart. So there is a thing that is running on the backend. That is actually running, a program is running on the backend whenever you're storing it any of your cart. So then any program is running on the backend, which is allowing you to store this into a cart, which is adding it to your repository, which is deducting this socks from the repository that is available because you are now going to buy this sock. In case any other person will come to buy this socks, he will be not seeing this inventory in case you have taken the last piece. So all these logics are being made in the application. From where this is being accessed is the database. A socks, I have 5 socks. As you put it in your cart, or as you purchase it, 5 will become 4. So these are the 3 layers that work in any of the application. Okay, the backend is this application layer that is working. This database layer that is working is a backend layer. Frontend layer is a website on which you have been working on. So Django and Flask are used to develop this frontend application. Python also gives you the capability to develop this application layer as well, logic. When you are buying a socks, in case it's a last piece, then this inventory will not be displayed on the screen. All these logics, Python also provides the capability, but the way to develop the front end is Django and Flask.
Sir?
Yeah.
ये जो हम algorithm use करते हैं वो कहाँ पे आएंगे इसके?
Application layer. Okay. Logical layer. Okay.
Hello, sir. It is used for deployment of the project model, I think.
Which thing?
deployment model which we created in machine learning and deep learning. If I'm not wrong.
Yeah. So any it's not with respect to machine learning or deep learning, but any model. In case you want to see a front end application of it, then Django and Flask are used in from Python. Apart from that, we have many other as well. ASP.NET. We have many languages that come and that go. So these are the front end applications. Whatever you want, whenever you want a person to view a page, view a website, view an application, that's the front end application. In case you're going with the Python, it is Django and Flask.
Is big data are available by Python or not?
So your voice is not audible, whosoever is speaking.
Big data can be work on Python or only Java is there?
So we have the capability to work on the big data through Python. Through Python we can work on. Now other applications like PySpark, Scala, and many more applications are also coming that helps you to analyze on big data. When we say analysis on big data, then Python is used. When you say working on big data, then Hadoop is used.
Sir, Hadoop,
and nowadays many more things are EMR, Elastic MapReduce, and many more things are there that helps you to work with the big data. But when you are analyzing on big data, then Python can also be used.
Models are, ML models are working on application layer or logical layer. So how many layers are there?
So there are, on a high level, there are three layers, which I've just told you. Database layer, application layer, and a front layer. In a three-tier architecture.
Pardon, sir, data layer?
Database layer? Application layer, logical layer, or development layer, normally call it, is a middle layer. And the front end is basically the front end layer. That is where we use this Django, Flask, and many more other things.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. So now the next concept is this. Keras, TensorFlow, Sklearn, this come under, these are the libraries in the Python which will help you to work on point number two. Machine learning, deep learning, or AI. In Python, these are the libraries. Which we will discuss later on. Even NumPy and Pandas. These are for numerical analysis kind of thing. These are not for predicting, but they are for analysis. So you will say this will come under one. NLTK, NLP, text mining. These come under languages. So I'll tell you about this. NLTK is a Python library. NLP is natural language processing. When you have a language in a form of a, say, Word document, in form of an Excel sheet, whenever any text is written, and you are analyzing that text, is through natural language processing or text mining. Both are the same things. With me?
Yes, sir.
SQL come under data engineering. It is a form of data access. Yeah. Anybody asking anything? Anybody any question?
No, sir.
When I say sequence learning has two terms. One of the sequence learning is used in NLP, and second sequence learning is called a time series as well. So both are the things. So it can come under six or say two. That is reinforcement learning. It's two. Time series, it is again two. So these are the terms that are used. Anybody, any doubt till now?
So you said we can categorize if we want to five numbers too, right? So you have said that if you want, we can categorize this all things into five numbers, like for data engineering, statistical analysis, report generation, predicting, and analyzing the data.
What do you want to know? I actually didn't get your question.
How we can predict all these things into only five different terms which you have said before, like data engineering.
So I told you the numbers. Yes. Business analytics comes under 1, 3, or 4, which are similar. Deep learning comes under predicting the future. AI comes under predicting the future. So that's why I have written the numbers over here, in which categories these will fall. So there is nothing that is going out of these six categories.
Okay, sir.
So let me tell you guys, what is machine learning? What is deep learning? What is AI? Okay. So let's say example. If I'll take an example of a 3 or 4 year old kid, let's say. So if you'll ask a 1 year kid to jump from a 5th staircase to the ground floor, will he jump? Only a 1 year kid who is very new to this world.
Yes,
he will jump. Yes, he will jump. And the same question, if I ask from a 6, 7 year old kid to jump from a 5th staircase to the ground floor, will he jump?
No.
Maybe, or basically no, because he has an idea how much is the height, whether he will be able to jump easily or not. In case he is not, then he will say no. Okay. Exceptions apart, a child is actually naughty and he wants to do all these things. All these exceptions apart, I'm generally taking a normal scenario. Whatever I'll say to a 1 year old kid who is very new to this world, who has not seen what is pain, what will happen if he will fall around. So what will happen? So he doesn't. If you say, ask him, he will jump because he is gaining experience with time. But the other child who is 7, 8, 9, 10, whatever you say, has gained a bit of experience where he has an idea that if he will jump from 5th, 6th, 7th staircase, then there is very high probability that he will get hurt. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So what it is? So a person who is a child who is 9 years is not jumping, but a child who is 1 year is jumping. The reason is, with time, that particular person has gained certain experience with him. He also have tried jumping from a bigger heights. He got hurt. Now he does not want to do it again. He don't want to do it again because he knows somewhere in the mind it is fed that if he will jump again from this, then there is very, very high probability that he will fall down. With me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, whatever learning this person has, this child has, if I put all this learning, all these historical dates of any of the event in the computer, okay, let's example. I'll say in the month of every day, what is the weather? 1st of January, it is cold. 2nd January, it is cold. 3rd January, it is cold. 4th January, it is cold. When it comes to February, it is like okay kind of a weather. Like you can basically, yeah,
moderate cold.
Yeah, basically a moderate kind of weather. In the month of March, it is a bit hot. In the month of April, this is again more hot. In the month of June,
it is rainy. In the month of July, it is rainy. In the month of August, it is humid. So all this everyday data for last 20 years, I have fed into a computer. Now, if you, let's example, if you want to go out from your home on 8th of July, will this machine, will the computer, will be able to tell you that there is 70% probability that it will rain today? Can this happen? Can this thing happen?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Why? How? Because machine has all the learnings on the back end. Historical learnings. Machine has historical experience, historical data. Machine has on the, in the form of data. So this is when machine learns on the historical data and predicts for the future, then it is known as machine learning. So here, there are two things that play a very important role. One is, three things that actually play a very important role. One is historical data. Okay. Second is machine's ability to learn. Third is, this is that learning, but machine is predicting. Anything else which you can think apart from this that is there in this problem?
So what is the third one?
Machine's capability to predict whatever the machine has learned from the history. With me?
Yes.
Yes.
So this is machine learning. Now machine has the, with this, machine has the capability to learn. So this is machine learning. But whenever machine has a capability to learn from the historical data and predict the future is machine learning. So now this historical data comes in a form of a database. That is a field of data engineering where the data is being stored. It can be in an Excel format. It can be in SQL format. It can be in big data. It can be in anything. Okay. This phase of learning, the machine's phase of learning and predicting, point number two and point number three, machine's ability to learn and predict comes under the category of model building, algorithm building in the machine learning. So machine learning will ask the machine to learn from the historical data. This is known as developing an algorithm, which means giving capability to the machine to learn from the historical data is known. This entire concept is known as machine learning. So this is a combination of database and the algorithm that we have been making, basis which machine is learning and predicting. So I hope this concept is clear to you. What is machine learning?
So it means that identifies the pattern in the data.
Yeah, it identifies the pattern in the data. It identifies the probabilities in the data. It identifies a number of sequences in the data and can predict in case any of the situation comes that has been covered or near to whatever mentioned in the historic.
So these algorithms comes under the statistical analysis.
No, this algorithm comes under machine learning.
So, sir, the machine will learn from the data and give the output.
Yeah.
Okay. So, can you give an example, please?
So, let's say example. So, the same example which I have told you, you have the historical. So, let's say example. Out of the total number of patients, let's example. We have a scenario in a hospital. A person goes for n number of tests. say a biopsy, MRI, a number of tests, and basis that it will be detected whether the person has a cancer or the person does not have the cancer, which means the person is benign or the malignant. Benign mean doesn't have cancer, malignant is the person has the cancer or a tumor. Let's see. So now I have the data for historical 20 lakhs patients. Okay. Now, basis these reports, doctor sees the reports and says it is a cancer or it is not a cancer. So that is a normal scenario that normally happens in the industry all the time. So now if I give all this data to the machine, that if a person has this much of this much of that, this much of this much of that, then person has a cancer. This much of this much of that, this much of this much of that, say we are capturing 20 variables, 20 data points, and basis that it is being said whether the person is, doctor understands the 20 variables and says, doctor asks the person to go for 20 checks, reports, MRI, CT scan, biopsy, and number of 20 scans, and the doctor says that it is a cancer or it is not a cancer. Now, if I'll provide this 20-year data to the machine, 20-year data to the machine for 20 lakh patients, that will, and in case any new patient comes and doctor is not available, I only enter these data points, 20 data points, which have been collected through 20 reports in a computer, and algorithm is being deployed on the back end, the machine can also predict there are 99% chance that the person doesn't have the cancer or the person has the cancer. This is the variables that are available. So this eliminates the role of the doctor. Machine has taken the role of the doctor based on the historical data which machine has learned.
Okay, sir.
Anybody else, any question?
Yes, sir. Sir, what is the difference between a machine learning algorithm and a deep learning algorithm?
I'm coming to that.
Sir, machine learning gives only binary output like yes or no or...
No. Machine learning can be any output. It can be a output that ranges from 1 to 10 lakh, 20 lakh, whatever you can think of. Machine learning can be binary output. Machine learning cannot be a binary output.
So, like,
please go on.
So, like you have categorized into the predicting the future.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and data mining, I guess you have categorized in 1, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
So, how means data mining is also doing the same thing? It is extracting information from the data.
That's an example. I just told you about machine learning. Now I'll come to the another concept. It is what is 1, 3, and 4 concept. So let's example. You have the data, the same cancer data that you have. In this cancer data, you have analyzed that one of the variable is what is the age of the people. So you have analyzed the people with age more than 50 have 70% or 80% of the people who have age more than 50 has cancer. That is, has cancer. So what is this? Am I predicting something? No. I'm just generating the insight from the whatever data I have available. So this is a insight generation through data analysis. This comes under category 1, 3. And if we'll add a statistical angle to it, which we will learn later on, so then this will come under the category of 1, 3, and 4. I am not predicting anything here. I'm just analyzing with whatever data that I have. This is data mining. This is exploratory data analysis. I've been exploring the data. This is data mangling. This is data wrangling, whatever you call it.
Okay, I got it.
Yeah, somebody also has some other questions.
Yeah, sir, in machine learning, sir, then can we take it as an example that a company is having a profit of, you know, X amount in 2020, so can we predict the amount, profit of 2021 through machine learning?
Yes.
Okay. Like in amount, not like that it will go in profit or it will go in loss.
Both the things.
Okay. You can predict.
Okay. So if it is clear, I'll come to the next concept, deep learning AI.
Yes.
So now, with time, when machine learning came into existence, so machine learning was into existence from 1950s and even before that as well. But the algorithms are very, very limited. The computational capabilities are very limited. So now, with the development of the machine learning, the new thing that came into industry is whenever we have this data that is available in the form of text, in the form of images, in the form of videos, and a number of things, then we need more faster processing, and then the size of the data also increases. Let me take an example. So first of all, this deep learning and AI are the same terms. Artificial intelligence and deep learning is the same concept. Deep learning is learning from a different kind of a data. So let's example, the example which I have just taken is I have the data of this cancer patient, okay, in which I have, what I have is, I have the historical data of 20 lakh patients that I had. Okay, so this comes under the normal data that is So when I have taken example of this data that is like a relational data of 20 lakh patients. So instead of that, I have the picture of that tumor. I have the picture of that tumor that I have obtained through ultrasound or any other CT scan, whatever you say. And now I'll ask the machine to take this image and tell me. So earlier what I've been taking, I'm not taking the image, but I'm taking the 20 variables, whatever came from this 20 reports. Now I have been passing this image to the machine, and I'm asking the machine to learn whatever the machine can learn from this image and predict whether it is a cancer or not. Or the feature that you have seen is Google Lens. Is when you have click a picture of a tree and just hover your mobile to n number of trees, it will detect which is a similar kind of a tree that for which the picture you have clicked on. This is a deep learning, which means machine will automatically convert the image into data, learn from it, and predict that particular image only. This comes under the category of deep learning. Are you guys with me?
Sir, I don't see any difference.
No, there's a difference. Earlier, I have provided the data to the machine. Data is in form of rows and columns. Now I've been providing the image to the machine. So you see,
Kind of data is different, like unstructured and structured data.
Yeah, so deep learning is basically a thing that is more prevalent on the unstructured data. One, the you got it right. And second difference is when the data is unstructured, this means the size of the data is very high. So when, if I'll click your image and if I'll convert it into a data, this will be converted into 28 into 28 into 3 size matrix, 28 rows, 28 columns. So again, another is 28 rows, 28 columns, and multiply all this with 3. A single image of yours will come to 1056 data points. So normal machine learning. So here, the second thing is, earlier, we are providing the ready data to the machine. And here, we are providing an image to the machine. The ability to convert this image into a data is still with the machine only, which earlier in the machine learning, the machine doesn't have. One difference. Second is the type of data that we have been providing. Earlier, we have been providing a data, a small size of a data. Now, every data point that I have been providing carries a data points of 1,000, 10,000 data points. Two, second difference. Third difference is the normal capability of a machine to learn that was there in the machine learning was limited by its algorithmic power. But now the power of the algorithm will also increase. So these are the three differences when it comes from machine learning to deep learning. So deep learning is nothing deep learning or AI is nothing but advancement of machine learning. Now is it clear?
Yes, sir. So nowadays, is it required to use machine learning algorithms or on industrial level, or your people use deep learning algorithms directly?
So let's say example, if I'll give you a nail, and I'll ask you to put it in your wall. So, and on the other side, I'll give you as an instrument is a hammer and a drill machine and a crane. So which thing you will use to put this nail into your wall? A hammer or a drill machine automatically? Because
yes,
these are the things that are used to put this into your wall. These are sufficient. But in case I'll give you a very huge rock or a huge kind of a thing, and you have to put it in a well, then you will use a crane. Okay, so that's the difference. In case you're working on a simpler problems, then deep learning will be a overfitting. I'll tell you what is overfitting, what is underfitting, n number of things. So deep learning has certain applications, and if you'll try to, if I'll say you need to predict the share market price. So normal thing that goes with the machine learning only, but as you go with more accuracy, more minute n number of things, and more number of things you have collected with the help of which your data has become so huge, then deep learning is a thing that comes into consideration. So when we have
depends.
Come again.
Basically, it depends on how much you want to invest.
How much you want to invest? One, what is your computational power? That is only. Yes. Third is what is the size of the data that you have? That again comes to invest. How much more data you want to collect with respect to that problem? Let's say, example, you want to predict the weight of a candy. One problem. Second is you want to predict the weight of gold coin. Third, you want to predict the weight of a diamond, a very precious diamond. Okay, so if you want to predict the weight of candies, you won't be investigating too much because there is very less cost that is involved if you are predicting anything bit here and there, and normal kind of algorithm will work. But when it comes to a deep learning, you will be requiring more data points with different angles, with respect to images, with respect to different angle images, and number of things that comes into research, which goes beyond the capability of machine learning, and automatically it will fall into the category of deep learning. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So, sir, for the candy, we can use machine learning, but for diamonds, and we have to use deep learning.
No, so the thing is, this is just an example. When we say diamond or gold, you will be collecting much more data. So when it comes to candy, you will also be, you will only be taking a brand of a candy and then, but when it comes to gold coin, you will be clicking its picture as well. Okay. Okay. Which will not be a thing in a machine learning. You have a limited data set. You have a limited kind of a problem, and you are giving a limited or a good kind of, even machine learning are very much capable. They will solve 99% of the problems. But when it is required to move beyond that, then what you will do? You will go with researching for more data points. So if I'll take an example, simple example. Let's example, you are going to find your son or daughter, whatever you have or you don't have. So any of your relative, for example, has a son or daughter, you're going to find a ball with the help of which a child can play. Okay. And on the second side, you're going to find a school for your kid. So now in both these examples, how much research will you do?
We have to more research on the school.
You will collect And what do we mean by more research? You will collect more data points.
More information.
Yeah, more information, more data points. In case of a ball, you will simply go to a market nearby, whether the ball is 50 rupees, 40 rupees, 60 rupees. You are not very much worried. You will purchase the ball and give it to your kid. But when you go to school, you will collect more data points. When it comes to ball, one or two points that you will see is what is the weight of the ball, what is it a good brand or not? One, two variables you will collect and you will give that ball to your kid. But when it comes to schools, you will visit the school, you will see the playground, you will click some of the images, you will ask the students who have already been studied from this school, you will ask about the result percentage which the school has, you will ask education level of teachers, you will ask what is the total area, you will ask that which kind of students come to this school. So you will at least collect 50, 40, 30, whatever variables you have, you can collect. Okay. But now, once these variables that you are collecting comes from a normal scenario, when it goes beyond the range of the normal data, data that can be stored in rows and columns, and it comes to, you click the image of a school as well, you click the pictures of a school as well, and you're analyzing it. Then it goes beyond the capability of machine learning to analyze this much variety of data. And it automatically comes to the category of deep learning. And with the help of deep learning, whatever outcomes that will come are known as AI, artificial intelligence kind of a outcomes that will come from deep learning problems. Are you with me?
Yes, no. Sir.
Anybody else? Any more questions?
No, sir.
So now you guys clear with what is business analytics, data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence, data engineering. Are you guys clear with these 5-6 concepts?
Yes, sir.
The second, the another thing which I'll discuss with you is what is sklearn, what is Keras, what is TensorFlow, what is LSTM, what is RNN, and number of things. So this NumPy pandas, all these things which I've just talked about are the libraries in the Python which gives you capability to perform which kind of analysis you want to perform. Sklearn give you capability to work on machine learning. Sklearn is a capability in Python which enables you for machine learning. Keras and TensorFlows are the capability and even more with the Python which help you to work on deep learning. Okay. NumPy and Pandas are the capability in Python which performs you or which enables you to do exploratory kind of a data analysis. Okay. Like a EDA, like a basic analysis kind of a thing that can be done through NumPy and Pandas. NLTK is a library in Python which help you to analyze the text data, which it is known as natural language toolkit.
Hello.
Are you with me?
Hello.
Yeah.
Can we combine deep learning and machine learning model, both concepts in the same model?
Yeah, we can do that. So it depends. So normally you can apply deep learning on the simple machine learning problems as well, but you cannot apply machine learning on a deep learning problems. Okay. You can.
Yeah, I have doubt here. As you said, I cannot apply machine learning concepts with deep learning. So I have doubt. Let's say, for example, so when you predict that the patient has, COVID positive or negative. Hmm. So based on the, RT or RT test, you cannot conclude the patient has positive or a negative. You need to figure out how much the patient has been infected with the COVID virus or not. So for that, we need another report with the CT scan. So which is another image data. So in that scenario, can we combine
both the data, I mean text data with the PT and CT results and the image data as a CT scan image data, and we need to analyze both the data and we can come to a conclusion whether the patient has this much of infection and has a positive and
definitely,
they don't have.
Definitely, yes.
So in that scenario, we can combine the both algorithms in the same model, right? So
yeah. So when we say deep learning itself has a capability of machine learning.
Okay.
Sir. So when we say neural network, it comes under machine learning. But when we say deep neural networks, which has some extra capabilities, that it then it will become deep learning. So deep learning itself has a capability of machine learning.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, when we train a data through machine learning and deep learning, and if we put a new data to it, so will the machine learning and deep learning update after after giving the test data?
I didn't get your question. So the question is, we have two data, one is train data and second test data. If we have made the model on the train data and we ask the machine to predict on the test data, so is it a similar kind of thing you're asking?
Will machine learning algorithm will update the model after giving the test data or not?
So it depends on certain algorithms. Certain algorithms are very powerful that if you'll ask them to test multiple times on the test data, then they will learn the inherent capability of the test data as well. So that's why we normally segregate data into train, test, and validate.
Okay.
But so with some of the algorithms, which when we'll come to algorithm, then this question will make more sense, because the reason is there are certain algorithms in machine learning and deep learning which have the capability to learn the data, whatever data you provide to it, it will learn the inherent capabilities. Because in test, you will give the test data, then you will match it with the actual output. Again, if you do that, it will keep on learning the attributes of the test data. But these are a limited kind of algorithms.
It will update after the
test data. Your voice is very low to me. I rarely hear.
Sir, it means the machine learning and deep learning also update the algorithm itself, means the model itself.
No, I'm saying not all machine learning models. Only a limited models in the machine learning have the ability to learn the attributes from the test data itself. But only a limited 5 or 10% of the machine learning algorithm have that. Rest, if I'll say linear regression, logistic regression, if I'll say naive Bayes, they don't have that much of it. But when we say support vector machine or neural network, they have the capability.
Okay, sir.
Sir, what is the difference between, or I should say, how deep neural network is different from a simple neural network?
So deep neural network has many more neurons to learn. So let's example, if I'll say there's a fruit fly. So, okay, let's example. If I'll ask you a question, how the cat catches the rat. Rat is also very, very smart. Rat also runs in a way that it is beyond the range of a human being to catch a rat. That's why we put a rat luring, a cage kind of a thing, which with the help of which the rat comes automatically. But cat catches the rat. How?
Well, it has to form its own strategy. First of all, it has to detect if there is a rat in her vicinity or not.
So it has, and, it has extra smelling power. It has extra flexibility. It has extra strategic capability. It has extra decision-making capability. How it is coming from? Because the mind of the cat has more number of neurons as compared to the mind of a rat. Okay. And in a similar way, the lowest
number of neurons lies in a fruit fly, which only takes the decision whether on the basis of its sense, whether there's some fruit available, yes or no. And second is to worry about their survival. When we work on neural network, so a simple fruit fly has around 10,000 neurons in the mind of a fruit fly. But a neural network that we have been developing has only 3 or 4 neurons. Even it is very less powerful than a fruit fly as well. But fruit fly has 10 number of decisions to make about its survival, about the fruit, about if somebody is hurting, somebody is not hurting. But our algorithm with 5 neurons, which are 20 times lesser than, or say 100 times or 50 times lesser than a fruit fly's brain, has the ability to predict n number of things because these 5 neurons are focused on solving a particular kind of a problem. But when we say deep neural networks, it has many number of, it has much more number of neurons in form of hidden layers as compared to neural networks. So that's why deep neural networks are different from the normal neural networks.
So deep neural network is the one which has hidden layers, and a simple neural network is
Deep neural network has much more hidden layers with much more number of neurons as compared to a simple neural network, which can also have 2-3 layers, but in deep neural network, it can go to 20, 30, 40 layers as well.
Okay.
Anybody else, any question?
Yes, sir. What is train data and test data?
So train data and test data is whenever we have any of, basically we will cover this concept out once we will start working on the machine learning things. The train data and test data is when you have, so let's say, you have 100 data points and you will ask the machine to learn on the 100 and predict on 101st. So let's say, the example which I have taken is, I have the data of 20 lakh cancer patients historically, whether the person has cancer or the person doesn't have cancer. So now if I'll ask the machine to be trained on this 20 lakh data points and print on the new patient, how will I be sure that the machine, whatever the machine is predicting, is right or not? So instead of training the machine on 20 lakh data set, I'll ask the machine to learn on 19 lakh data sets and give the prediction on 1 lakh data set. And what I'll do is, I'll match what the machine has given as output with what the actual output I have for this 1 lakh patients. So this 19 lakh data set is a trained data, and on which I'm asking the machine to test on is the, this 1 lakh data is the test data. With me?
Yes, sir. How do we match the output, like via graph or some?
So we have the output that is being predicted by the machine, one. We have the output that is actual output of this 1 lakh data point, with the help of which we can map it over the graph. We can check the accuracy of the machine learning model that we have made, and we can do a number of things.
Okay, okay. Okay, sir.
Anybody else, any question? Any doubt, anything that is not clear in this session?
No, sir.
Sir, then what is data science?
Data science basically says the point number 2, predicting the future with is a thing that comes under the category of data science. Point number 2 is purely data science.
So this is different from machine learning, deep learning, AI.
This is the same. When we embed machine learning, deep learning, and AI into a single bucket, it is a bucket of a data science. Or a data scientist has a capability who can apply machine learning, deep learning, and AI.
Okay, means all of this is the part of data science.
The art of applying machine learning and deep learning and AI is known as a data science.
Okay.
Sir, in other words, can we say that the combination of statistical tools, languages, and the domain knowledge, like business knowledge, is data science?
So business knowledge does not come under data science. Business knowledge is
like means the data and all that we collect from the
business. So basically understanding the data. So this data science also has the capability, data scientist also has a capability to do this point number one as well. Basically do a basic analysis of a data or point number four as well. So because to do this predictive modeling, you need to know point number and point number four. So to go on stair four, you should have the, you should be knowing how to climb the stair one and stair two. So a data scientist has a capability to analyze the data and to predict the data with the help of the three things which I have just mentioned. So this is the capability of a data scientist. So all the things like domain knowledge and all other things, in case from a business perspective, doesn't come under the purview of data science.
Okay,
sir.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, ये जो business analytics होता है, इसमें और data science में क्या difference होता है?
Business analytics, data analytics is a way of analyzing the data. Data science or this predicting is basically the capability of predicting the data. So the person who knows predicting the data should also be knowing the business analytics and the data analytics both. But a person who knows the business analytics and data analytics, if and doesn't know the machine learning and AI, then the person is known as the analytics kind of a person. Business analyst. And all this category will fall when a person doesn't know machine learning, deep learning, and AI, but the person knows the business analytics, basic analysis, developing EDA? Insights. ED is also part of business or data analytics.
Yeah, sir. Means like a business analyst must know like EDA, but EDA. Might not know machine learning or
data. Machine learning. But a data scientist should know EDA. So EDA, data analytics, and this business analytics is just an ABCD for the data scientist. So a person who basically knows the prediction modeling always knows like these things. So data scientist is automatically, when I say a person knows machine learning, then exploratory data analysis, data mining, data mangling, and all these things will automatically come into consideration. If I say there's a person who is running very fast. This means the person already knows how to walk.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Any other question anybody has?
No, sir.
Well, guys, so this is basically the topic for today. When I need to take you through the basic of it. So that is the thing. So my way of teaching is similar only. But today I've just told you about the concepts. In the future learnings, I'll be taking the live examples. I will not be using any PPT, any deck, any presentation, formal kind of a thing. My only preferred way is learning with the examples, which we will be going for the future things as well.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Sir, can you tell about data which we would use in future modeling, means tomorrow's lecture, so we can download it?
No. So I'll be generating the data during the class only. And in case I have been downloading the data from any of the website, I will be providing you the link then and there only. So whenever, so let's say, example, I'll be generating a data of any two fruit vendors who has fruits and vegetables. So I'll be writing the names then and there only.
Okay.
So is it clear, guys?
So actually, I have one basic question, like general basic question.
Yeah, please, please.
Sir, these voice recognition technologies like Alexa, Siri, sir, these also work on intelligence, right?
This is, yeah, deep learning and artificial intelligence.
Sir, so I want to know that how it works, sir. Like if we are asking something to them or we are feeding any data, how do they know that what they have to reply and know all that?
So this is basically, so the thing that is going on is, as we are speaking something to it, so we are providing learning to this Alexa or whatever it is. As we speak, in case that the thing, whatever you are saying is not embedded into the system, the Alexa will say, sorry, I don't know this. But on the back end, Alexa is taking that voice and embedding it into the historical data. The people who are working on this technology are finding the suitable answer for that. In case any of the thing is coming multiple times, multiple times, then they are finding the suitable answers for that as well. They're also embedding how this problem can be solved and all these things they have been doing on the back end. And it is coming to a problem where the historical data is being embedded a lot. But the type of data is different. It is voice to text.
So you mean to say that suppose if I say something and it is not embedded in the system, then the technology will learn the answer and the next time somebody uses that, they will reply.
So it might be, in case multiple users are asking for a same thing, then automatically the machine will learn.
Like itself. Like
if not by itself, then somebody who is working on this Alexa algorithm or organization, Amazon or whatever, is embedding the answers to it automatically or making the machine learn, or the machine is learning by itself.
Okay. And also, sir, if we ask something and they are giving the solution to it, that also is already embedded in the historical data.
Already embedded in the data that this machine is carrying.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir, that's all. Thank you.
Okay. Well, guys, in case anybody has questions, then I can wait for next 20-30 seconds, then I'll drop off.
Sir, this data analysis is completely about theory, right? It doesn't have any kind of programming like earlier we have studied in Python.
It has programming, but it does not have programming. It has scripting. Very limited lines of program that I will be writing. But it has a practical aspect as well. It is not a theoretical all the time with data analytics.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Then, sir, from tomorrow, we will start machine learning.
So from tomorrow, I will be taking you through, not the machine learning, the statistical analysis, like the thing that we have just read, hypothesis testing, t-test, z-test, central limit theorem, and a number of things I will be telling you. Starting from mean, median mode, standard deviation, normal distribution, distributions, all these things we will be covering.
Okay, sir.
Okay, guys.
Okay,
so thank
sir.
You very yeah, thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow at 8:30. Bye.
Good night, sir. Bye.
Good night, sir. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.